That we can start the last session since we are running a bit late. So I've asked the speakers to keep their comments to up to 8 minutes so that we have some time for discussion at the end and not just presentation. So this is the session that we bring some more facts, some more specific topics within the One Belt, One Road initiative. So we'll start with the host, Sean, who is also co-author of the Peterson study, who would talk about some, let's say, some concerns, issues to watch as the initiative develops. Then among our Chinese guests, colleagues, we will talk about the currency, the internationalization of the currency, something that I mentioned in my remarks, other people mentioned. We'll then talk about trade and investment within the initiative. And finally, energy, the focus on energy and in general energy projects, what the future that that is. So please, we're a bit late starting. Let's keep our comments short. Sean.
Okay. So the Belt and Road Initiative is entering a very important time for moving forward. China's economy has slowed down a bit. The reform efforts appear to have stalled. And China wants to signal that its journey to move to the upper echelon of global economic influence has not wavered. China's policy laid out by Deng Xiaoping, keeping a low profile and focusing on internal development, has been put aside for a more assertive international economic stance. China's proactive economic diplomacy in Asia has been viewed skeptically by some as some countries view too much dependence on China as strategically risky. So now I'll lay out a few of the concerns that I have about the initiative going forward. And the first is on the management, the leadership of this initiative. So there are questions about who is coordinating this effort. We do understand that on the government side, you know, we have a Belt and Road office in the NDRC, and on the party side, we have some folks at the Central Leading Group for Comprehensively Deepening Reform taking control of that. But who's making sure that some of these projects don't overlap and that there is some, you know, synergy in the initiatives? Further, two-thirds of the countries on the in the Belt and Road have credit ratings of either unrated or below investment grade. This makes many of the projects financially more risky, but also has the positive effects of lending for infrastructure projects where it's most needed. So a balance there. Third is the over-promising of either financing or projects. There have been promises of over $600 billion in projects, but as of the end of 2015, there were only $200 billion in hard capital. I know Simeon said actually $400 billion, so maybe there's been $200 billion in the last 4 months, but which wouldn't be surprising in China's case. But still, a lot more has been promised. Pakistan is an example here where $45 billion has been promised, but only less than $10 billion has actually been lent. So an area to watch. Finally is the state-owned enterprises that are going to be involved in this. Are the SOEs going to use this as a way to continue their development, even if some of them are grossly in an overcapacity situation? as we've heard about the zombie companies, large bloated firms moving forward just without real motivation for profit. Basically, the SOEs need, some of the SOEs need to downsize, or we've seen some consolidation, but maybe the BRI actually stalls or slows this project further. There have been some very positive signs, and I was was lucky enough to be at the China Development Forum last month, and the head of the Silk Road Fund, Gene Chi, stressed five very important issues that shows that China has some very strong leadership in the right areas. She stressed that when pursuing the Belt and Road initiatives, China should focus on policy coordination, emphasis on sustainability and long-term viability. They should look more into joint financing, public-private partnerships, and also make sure that the guarantees are have sovereign guarantees and be profit-oriented. And finally, that social benefits should be brought to those near the projects and include respecting local traditions and the environment. More positive signs in terms of actual projects. Germany has jumped aboard on China's Belt and Road Initiative. Recently, the 200th train, the block train, arrived from Wuhan to Hamburg. This is a train that basically carries the same good from the same origin to the same destination, but now they're experimenting with less than container load and diversifying products on each train. Deutsche Bahn and China Rail have partnered to increase the amount of freight service between China and Germany, besides what's happening on the Trans-Siberian Railway. And China's plans for a southern route that bypasses Russia through Iran have made some significant progress, including the first train that has arrived from China to Tehran. So very, very positive signs. So I'm going to wrap up with 5 points on areas to watch in Belt and Road Initiative going forward. First one, I think nuclear is something everybody should be watching out for. China's five-year plan makes nuclear a priority for the Belt and Road, and the focus is on Southeast Asia and the Middle East. Turkey has plans to build 4 plants in the next 12 years, and China has already initiated conversations to facilitate building of those. China's offering prices 25% of what Western companies offer to build nuclear power plants. Second is the Air Silk Road. Aviation has entered the picture, and China has earmarked $80 billion for Belt and Road projects in terms of aviation, airports, et cetera. Oil and gas, we've spoken about it today. Another project is the Silk Road Fund has put a 10% equity stake in a liquid natural gas firm in northern Russia. Plus to loan an extra $3 billion. So we're not just talking pipelines, but China is facilitating development of extraction as well. The role of Hong Kong is also something to watch. Hong Kong's chief executive mentioned the Belt and Road nearly 50 times in a recent address. So the Hong Kongese are getting behind this. And finally, regional security challenges. Will China take a more prominent role when the heat rises near any of its major infrastructure projects in the Belt and Road countries? China's policy of non-intervention may be tested, and I think it shouldn't be so hesitant to join international efforts to build solutions around these conflicts. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sean. Thank you. Now we'll turn to a topic that we already mentioned a couple of times earlier in the day, the Chinese currency, making it more international, how this fits within the One Belt, One Road and beyond. Please, and we have also a presentation.
There is a mistake, a typing mistake. in the handout, it should be RMB internationalization, not RMB what is this? And Professor Yu Miaojie is from the Peking University, and Dr. Yu Jiantuo is from China Development Foundation, who is in the audience. Okay. So the Belt and the Road initiative provides a good opportunity for RMB internationalization. RMB internationalization gives facilities for Belt and Road initiatives. I will talk just with the relation with the two, but not generally about RMB internationalization. The RMB internationalization refers to the process to use RMB internationally and finally become RMB become a major currency, become one of the major currency in the world. It is a process, it's a long process, and it was pushed by market and the government. And there's a significant progress have been made during the past several years. So I have some numbers for RMB settlement for trade is about 7 trillion RMB, and RMB settlement for investment is about 2 trillion RMB. People's Bank of China has signed a currency swap agreement with 33 countries and the European Central Bank with the amount of about 3 trillion RMB in world. And our RMB offshore market keeps expanding, first in Hong Kong, now in a lot of different cities in the world. A currency become an international currency need to meet some of the basic requirements. First, the size of the economy, the development of financial system, the openness of trade, and the overall risks of the nation. You can see China meet some of the requirements, but not all of them, to become a fully qualified for internationalized currency. China needs a lot to do to reform its financial system. The effect of Belt and Road on RMB internationalization are through three channels. First, the trade channel. You can see the trade between China and those countries hit about USD 1 trillion, about one quarter of China's foreign trade, and it developed quite quickly in the past 10 years. And second channel is the investment channel. These countries are severely lack of infrastructures, and if China increases investment in this area to 30%, then the investment in the coming decade will be something like $2 trillion. And the third channel is currency reserve channel. We estimated the effects of Belt and Road initiative on RMB internationalization. It is we expect RMB settlement for trade in the next 5 years cumulated is about RMB 6 trillion. And that is a cumulative number. And settlement for RMB in direct investment will be about 2 trillion RMB. In the short run, the fluctuation of RMB exchange rate had some negative impacts on RMB internationalization. For example, in August last year, there is a sharp drop in RMB exchange rate, which affects the offshore RMB market badly. But we don't see any basis for continued depreciation in the long run based on the performance of Chinese economy. We did some econometric works on internationalization, on the RMB internationalization on bilateral trade. The dependent variable is bilateral trade. The explanatory variable is the swipe agreement, the number and the amount. And we found significant positive effects on the trade volume. Then finally, the policy recommendations. We think most of them for the Chinese government, both planning and management should be more specific and detailed, and also coordination between different countries and different agencies. And the more importance should be attached to insurance. The Belt and Road Initiative and RMB internationalization should be fully capitalized to deepen reforms of domestic financial and trade system. If you think the four requirements, China has need to do a lot of work to fulfill those requirements. So domestic reform is very important for RMB to become internationalized. And finally, the RMB internationalization can and should be proceed in an orderly way should be understood and supported by all countries in the region and in the world. And I hope RMB internationalization should make contributions to the establishment of a fair and inclusive world economic and financial and currency order. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Doctor. The next presentation is on the effect of One Belt, One Road on increased trade and investment cooperation.
Good afternoon. I will focus on trade and investment issues. This morning, people are talking about the motivation of the Belt and Road Initiative. I will not repeat that, but I think the key to realize the win-win result is to find the convergence of interests of all the countries involved in that. And I think to strengthen trade and investment cooperation is of great significance to achieve the goals I've just mentioned in the previous page. And a lot of attention has been paid to infrastructure connectivity, but I think trade and investment is also should be considered as the basis and priority among the five connectivities. Here I show you some figures about the trade and investment relations between China and the Belt and Road. The countries along the Belt and Road are not the main trading partners of China, and individually, I mean, and not the main destination or resource of mutual investment for China. But in the last 10 years, the region as a whole become increasingly important in China's total trade and ODI. And also, you can see that the after China put forward the initiative, we can see very outstanding performance of the bilateral and trade and mutual investment between China and the region, the higher growth of the blue column compared to the China's total trade and investment with the rest of the world. So I would like to talk a little bit more about the logic behind this kind of trade and investment relationship in the international trade and investment regime. We all notice that the world economy are in deep adjustment, and not only the downward pressures, but also we can we have seen that the global trade in the last 4 years has seen very bad performance, and also somebody call it kind of end of the hyper globalization period for the last decade. And there is an increasing sense of rising protectionism in the world. And also, we can notice there are some new trends of development in regional cooperation and integration. The figure, the rapidly growing number of FTAs notified to the WTO, and there is also a trend of mega FTAs, the TPP, the TTIP, and RCEP in Asia. And some of them, the TPP and TTIP, are focusing on high standard of market openness and rule setting. And also, actually, the countries along the Belt and Road are also facilitate their participation in this kind of regional integration. The thing is that actually the region are become a new source for world economic growth. We can see from this figure that they record higher GDP growth in the region than the world average, and also increasing contribution to the world economic growth to almost 45%. And also, the region becomes the kind of highlight in world trade and investment. We can see the higher growth rate, and to some extent, this kind of good, better performance can be attributed to the connectivity improvement in the region, according to UNCTAD, the World Investment Report. I think there are some good things that we should consider, but also we are facing with some challenging realities, that is the coexistence of both difficulties and challenges. One is the generally low and very different level of development. I will not go into details. And another is the level of openness is relatively low, and it's very kind of difficult for high standard economic integration for the region at the current under this current situation. Some countries just joined WTO, some have not even joined, and there are inconsistencies of policies in terms of a custom clearance and also SPS, these sort of things. And also the region are highly rely on external market and has lower, they are positioned in lower end of the production, international production chain. We can see from this intra-regional trade index. And so finally, I would like to say that facing this kind of challenges and realities, it is essential to find a way that's suitable to this development status and the needs. First of all, it's the joint efforts and consultation are required. That according to international experience, big countries can play an important role in regional development. So China has the willingness and the capability to make more contribution, but the Belt and Road is not a mix of bilateral cooperation between China and the other countries. It's kind of establishing the platform for the whole cooperation platform for the whole regions. And also, I would like to say some people mentioned about TPP. I think the FTA is very important, but not the only driving forces for regional development and cooperation. There are many other types of economic cooperations, industrial cooperation, financial and innovation cooperation, and even capacity buildings. And third, and I think to deepen the economic integration should be conducted in a step-by-step manner, because some people say trade and investment are not adequate for deepening the regional integration. So I think there are some steps. I have that in my paper. You can get that later. And I think China, in this process, China can play a role of not only the initiator, but a contributor, and or to some extent a facilitator. So there was different kind of relations China need to handle well. But I would like to emphasize on about the intra-regional cooperation versus cooperation with other countries. That's the China are willing to invite and attract more participants, because we prefer the kind of open cooperation in terms of areas, modes, and participants. So some final words, I would like to say that the Belt and Road Initiative is not a challenge to international trade and investment regime. And it's also not a sort of counter to TPP. Actually, it's rather a complementary, because it provides a new type of open, inclusive, and opportunity sharing and mutually beneficial cooperation to promote regional prosperity, economic prosperity, and stimulus toward economic development. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And the last topic that we thought would be useful for you to hear some more detail is One Belt, One Road, and then energy cooperation. Please.
Okay, thank you. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's my honor to be the last one. On behalf of our group, I will show some conclusion on energy cooperation and security under the Belt and Road Initiative. First is the background. It's also the reason why so many countries pay more attention to energy security, because the world is changing. As we know, in recent years, especially in the post-crisis era, there are many new changes in the global energy market. For example, the balance between a global energy supply and demand has changed from tightness to loss, and the Asian Pacific region has become the new center of energy consumption growth. And during this period, we know the international oil price has decreased sharply and kept at a low level of $40 per barrel. Low price seem to be a new normal in the long run. And also the LNG trade has developed rapidly, which can promote a unified global market for natural gas. There are also some new breakthrough of new energy, which will bring about a reform in the global new energy system. It's worth noting that every country is involved in the global energy system, so no country can avoid the risk, especially the systematic risk. So we think it's time for the proposed Belt and Road Initiative. It can become the new breakthrough on global energy cooperation and governance. It can be seen from this figure. The Belt and Road countries account for more than 50% of the global energy resources, especially for the fossil fuel. So we know resource is the basic for energy cooperation. And there are many advantages for energy cooperation under the Belt and Road. It has a widespread oil and gas pipeline networks, and it has formed multi-regional energy cooperation networks. And we think the Belt and Road countries has a great potential energy demand in the future. Of course, there are some shortage for the cooperation, because we know most countries in Belt and Road countries have the weak industry support system, and their pipeline capacity of infrastructure is limited. And they also have the undevelopment exploration and technology. And the current energy cooperation form is simple and single. They also face the high transportation risk, especially the oil trade pass through the Strait of Malacca and Hormuz. I think the Belt and Road Initiative has a clear vision and a priority for energy cooperation. It tends to form a large-scale cooperation framework and international cross-regional comprehensive and open cooperation as keywords. And it's also in accordance with the principle of mutual complementarity and mutual benefit. It will promote global energy security and explore new mode of energy governance. And it it also can improve the energy efficiency of new energy. And there are some targets for the energy cooperation. First, it can solve the bottleneck program for in energy field faced by these countries. And it can also encourage integrated and multi-level industrial chain for energy and resource cooperation. I think it can form a collective response mechanism to cope with the price volatility and the supply risk, and it can build an innovation mechanism for the development and use of new energy. It can also foster innovation in the global energy governance, also provide staying power for the developing countries and improve the rules of global energy cooperation. We suggest some following areas for cooperation. For example, it can build some platform for communication, for energy trade, and for financial support. And it can also construct an energy resource reserve mechanism, just like the IEA. And it can improve energy transportation networks by constructing some pipelines. And it can also promote the transfer and application of new energy technologies. We also do some quantitative research on the influence of Belt and Road Initiative on global energy governance. It can be found this initiative can greatly improve the stability of the global energy trade networks, and it can also effectively strengthen the global energy security. This figure shows the influence for the major exporters on different consumer regions. It can be found there is no significant difference for the impact on different regions. It implies diversification. It is a common policy for both supplier and consumer to spread their systematic risk. And we also can find the top three countries, such as Saudi Arabia, Russia, and the UAE. They contribute more than 40% of the stability to the stability of global oil trade. And according to our calculation, all the countries along the Belt and Road can contribute more than 60% to the stability of the oil trade. So it's the reason why we should do the energy cooperation under this initiative. And we also gave an evaluation of the investment risk for the One Belt One Road countries. It can be seen there is a large gap of investment risk among these countries. And we think the unstable political situation and high risk is the reason why there is so many ineffective investment. And we also believe the One Belt One Road initiative can provide some new bilateral and multilateral investment cooperation system, which can form an effective mechanism to control the risk and also can improve the efficiency. As we know, the Belt and Road Initiative can also provide improvement for the low carbon development, because it can accelerate the green and the low carbon development through the upgrading of energy patterns, and it can also promote the building of regional and international new energy cooperation platform. And it also can improve the large-scale natural gas utilization, especially for the shale gas and some other unconventional oil and gas. And so we can conclude, first, the Belt and Road Initiative can put forward new ideas about energy cooperation, because it can improve the global energy governance by converging various region fields and countries. It can extend the multi-level industry chain, and it's more flexible and complement for the existing strategies. We think it can benefit to less developed areas, especially in Asia, Europe, and Africa, and it can form a sustainable energy development pace. Second, it's consistent with the idea of global energy governance, and it's more inclusive because it's more open, and it can include the interest of all participate, whatever energy supplier, consumer, and transit countries. And it can form a unified platform for dialogue and cooperation. The third one is it conductive to global energy security and benefit all. It can guarantee to the security by keeping the stability of energy investment and trade. So we think the Belt and Road Initiative is not the disruption of the current rules of global energy governance. I think it can provide a new way and supplement innovation to the current global energy system. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you very much for all speakers. We've been a very disciplined panel, so we have about 10 minutes for comments and for questions. Let me just make a note that this is still a very new initiative with not so much factual evidence yet. There are a number of projects that are signed, but few are completed. So in a couple of years, it would be useful to repeat this exercise to see of the evidence that already exists, can we do some more rigorous analysis on some of the topics that we've discussed today. But please, some questions or comments from the audience, please.
Hi, Susan Lawrence from the Congressional Research Service again. I very much wanted to get at that question about the lack of definitive information. Your report, you give some statistics. You were talking in your presentation about 75% of the projects being infrastructure. This figure that 43% of the contracts financed by Chinese state banks are for OBOR projects. Were you able to find any definitive list of Belt and Road projects from which you could then say that 75% were infrastructure? I have not been able to find any authoritative list of projects, and I'm wondering if there is one out there. And even just a list of how many countries are there in the Belt and Road. At the National People's Congress, the three ministries in charge all gave different numbers. Mm-hmm. So the Ministry of Foreign Affairs said that there were agreements with 30 countries. The Ministry of Commerce, in its statistics, talks about 49 countries. The National Development and Reform Commission talked about 65 countries. And, of course, the number of countries then affects your statistics, because if 43% of your financing is for Belt and Road projects, but is that projects in 30 countries, or is that projects in 49 countries, or 65 countries? So I just wonder, both the Chinese participants and the American participants, if you could give us some sense of whether there are any definitive statistics and lists of projects out there, or when we might expect one. I understand there'll be an official website launching this year, if there's any more information on when that might happen. Thank you.
Thank you. Would any of our guests care to comment on this point of where do we find some, maybe not definitive, I think that we need to wait for some years, but some statistics on our side. As I mentioned in our report, we do have some statistics. They're a combination of some official government statistics. So, for example, for 2015, 41%, I think I mentioned, of all projects funded by Chinese financial institutions belong to the Belt and Road Initiative. That raised the question of what about the other 59? So who has it? Somebody must have at the central level a list, otherwise they wouldn't be able to come up with the 41%. But what it includes was the denominator, which is your point, not clear to me. What we've done for some of our work at Peterson is that we've gone country by country and have looked at where, and maybe this is where the fuzziness comes, where there is, let's say, a political agreement for a project, but then is there a document that actually specifies what this project is? Is there a signed document, which is a second category? And there are a number of such projects that are signed, but then getting to the more specific category, projects under construction, let's say, this is a much, much smaller list. So Sean mentioned, for example, that there should be $45 billion worth of projects in Pakistan, but we can find less than 10 that are actually signed. So the 35 is more in the area of at some point soon, hopefully it would happen. So that's why I think our next job on this project is actually to do some basic statistics and be able to attribute projects to this exercise and then on that base be able to ask some of the questions. But that's maybe in Chinese, from Chinese sources, there is more than we can see. Can anybody comment on this? Or
I'll just add something really fast. From the beginning, this was clear that this is an evolving initiative, very ad hoc, you know, some ministries taking control of some projects, other departments taking control. And I think a lot of what's happening is the president of China announced this initiative and a lot of people were eager to jump on board, and other ministries who haven't spoken to, you know, the people in charge, maybe at the NDRC or the other central leading group, you know, and they say, okay, well, this is projects Belt and Road, but they haven't, you know, conferred with the people who are really in charge. So a lot of people are jumping in on this, and that's probably why there's a lot of different statistics floating around. But
the one statistic that we were able to confirm, since we did project by project, is of early this year, there were about a quarter trillion projects that were actually under construction. Either finalized a few, but mostly under construction. So that's one figure that we can commit to, about $250 billion worth of projects that actually are on the ground and moving. I think all other numbers we still are collecting. Fred, you had a question.
Fred Berg said, I want to get away from the complexities of the numbers and ask a conceptual question of Qi Zhang. You said that Belt and Road is not an alternative to TPP. But it depends how you interpret, I think. As I understand Belt and Road, it is an effort to develop a trade and investment network or system between China and the participating countries, and maybe to some extent among the participating countries, I don't know. But your presentation said that, and the energy presentation also emphasized that in the energy sector. That would be a different kind of trade and investment relationship than TPP, which focuses on trade rules and trade barriers, particularly at the border, some behind the border. But conceptually, one could say this is an alternative methodology for developing closer trade and investment relations among the participating countries. And it would then be an empirical question which one was more successful in developing closer relations. I mean, we do studies that estimate the effect of reducing tariffs and improving standards on intellectual property, and those are just estimates, but we make those. But one could make estimates of what all these projects are going to add up to, and who knows, that could be a bigger number. So it's different approaches. And I'm not suggesting they are in conflict or hostile toward each other. Perhaps they would be complementary, at least for the countries that overlap the two systems. So let me just ask you to elaborate a little more why you said, I think that was your word, it's not an alternative to TPP, but might it be a complement to TPP? Might it be a system that could coexist, go into place alongside TPP, and even be mutually reinforcing?
Thank you, Fred. Please.
Yeah. Thank you for elaborate, actually, before my answer. I actually agree with you that TPP and the Belt and Road are different approach to regional development, especially on trade and investment cooperation. And I think in terms of institutional arrangement, these two are totally different, right? because the TPP is kind of regional free trade arrangements focusing on tariff elimination, reduction, or non-tariff barriers, and as you said, rule setting process. And the Belt and Road are focusing on trade and investment kind of promotion development program for the region. So I think from institutional arrangement, these two are quite different. And for some countries are kind of in the position of overlapping, participate in the two systems. I think they can benefit from both initiative or arrangements. And I think if you said there is kind of alternative to TPP in Asian region, there is RCEP to some extent. It's kind of counterpart or to TPP, but that is also based on the realities of lower level of openness to some member states, and also that's more suitable to the development status of the region. So probably you can see by the end different level of trade or investment liberalization by the two arrangements, but I think between TPP and RCEP, but I think between the Belt and Road and the TPP are, I cannot say completely different things, but one is exclusive, another one is open and inclusive to all kinds of cooperation modes and all kinds of participants.
Thank you. On that point, on another point, please.
I think Ms. Zhang, we have the same family name. her use alternative is in the sense that of political meanings. In Chinese or maybe in English, it means it is not another way, a way the Chinese government use it use it to counter the effect of TPP, things like that. So her, I think her, what she says is, I think the same as what you said, that the two programs can have common fields. It is not the something to counter the effects of TPP.
Maybe there's an additional point or question here, please.
Yeah, actually, I have a question because we have distinguished research fellows from Peterson Institute. Some people are saying that the Belt and Road Initiative is kind of shift China's position from the international agenda followers to kind of agenda setter. But China are not pursue the position of dominant power in the region. And so we prefer to use the existing mechanism and forums to establish the cooperation platform. But in some American experts and also European experts are saying that even after China published the action and vision and action plan, the details of the Belt and Road are still kind of sketchy and not clear. So they kind of put forward a proposal that actually China should initiate, establish a kind of overall architecture for design and supervise the development of the Belt and Road. I don't know what's your opinions on this. Is it kind of reasonable or needed or not?
Well, then I think it would become actually quite a competitor to TTIP and TPP and so on. If you start setting up this type of infrastructure, at least it would look that way. My personal view, it's not necessary. I think actually what is necessary is there is already a number, several thousand projects under this initiative that are signed and under different stages of development. I think what is useful is not to have more infrastructure around this, institutional infrastructure, but to have the analytical infrastructure to put these together and ask the question, what is this really about? Because we had several motivations listed today. It's not exactly a free trade agreement, as we've discussed, but it's not just pure investment in infrastructure, because investments are going beyond infrastructure in some countries. So I think additional institutional architecture to me is not needed, but additional infrastructure to do the analysis and the statistics behind it and say, as some people are asking, how do you know what is part of this and what is not part of this? And how do we know who is financing? We know there are many financiers, but there is not too much understanding of whether the money is simply passing, as is the case now. We know such cases where simply from the national budget it passes through one bank, through another bank. So essentially everybody counts as if they are part of the initiative, but in fact it goes through three or four different institutions to get to the final project. So I think it's too early, in my mind at least, to talk about the need for additional institutional infrastructure. Let's do some more projects. But maybe Fred has a much bigger expert on these issues.
Well, no, I think in that, just following up what Simeon said, an interesting question is the interaction between the One Belt, One Road initiative and the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, which was mentioned this morning. In several of your presentations from the Chinese side, you have seemed to give a significant role to the Asian Infrastructure Bank in supporting some of the Belt and Road projects. Last week, Jin Li Chun was in town. We talked with him about the Asian Bank, and he did not talk as much about financing Belt and Road projects, although he did mention it. To the extent that that bank did play a role, then you have a new institution, mm-hmm. which would have project selection techniques, governance structures that would provide partial infrastructure for the Belt and Road project, at least that part of it which it covered. And then an interesting question would be how much that got used or could be used for Belt and Road more broadly, even if the Asian Bank did not support a given project or maybe only supported a small part of a project. If you wanted to develop some infrastructure, that would be something you could build on, though, of course, that raises then the whole question of the purpose and governance of the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank. But there is some overlap there mm-hmm. that raises at least some possibility in the direction that you suggested. And I guess to put it the other way, if you set up some new administrative apparatus for the Belt and Road, it would possibly conflict with the governance structure of the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank to the extent that it came into the projects through its normal procedures. So you'd have to think about those kinds of interactions in trying to answer your question.
Yep. Thank you, Fred. Thank you, everybody. Time is up. This was an interesting panel and an interesting day. Hopefully, we can return to this topic in a couple of years with a lot more evidence to it and a lot more understanding of what it implies for these countries and for the whole world, really. It's such a large project. So thank you very much.